Bear back in the top flight, home match to kick off, unfurling the championship winner's flag.
Mm-hmm.
You're looking forward
to it? Oh, absolutely, absolutely. And I think most Dundee fans are eagerly looking forward to the game on Saturday against Motherwell. I looked at the table and we're sitting third at the moment. So I'm quite happy with that as things stand. But it's not, it's going to be really exciting. A new manager, lots of new players, George.
Yeah.
Lots of new players. Have they got a squad and a kind of put a team on the park there that can keep them finally? You know, that was the big... Gary Boyer said at the end of last season, you know, Dundee have to stop being a yo-yo team going up and down and up and down. You know, and the recruitment this season, I think, is slightly different. You know, you get the feeling that they've certainly... They've looked at the sort of mandate for a team that is going to keep you in that division, and it's not all going to be pretty football. Mm-hmm. You're going to need the physical side of things as well, and I think that's what let Dundee down the last time they were in the Premier League.
They were quite a small team.
They were. I felt they didn't match up to a lot of teams physically, and that cost them ultimately. But really looking forward to the game on Saturday against a Motherwell side who Stuart Kettlewell obviously took over towards the end of last season and had an unbelievable run just to took them into the top six, a team that was staring relegation in the face at one point and took them away. But, you know, I think a lot of Dundee fans think it's a good one for Dundee to start with, but Motherwell are a tough, tough side, and they've got a lot of boys who have played Premiership football for a long time. And, you know, you're just looking at their goalkeeper, Liam Kelly, and, you know, Lamy at the back. Callum Butcher, the man Dundee fans love to hate, and I think he's injured at this point in time, and I don't think he will be playing. You know, and they've got one or two others. Barry Maguire, I think, still at Motherwell, who was at Dundee last season.
So he was playing for Motherwell B, actually, this week, so I don't know whether he's getting the game.
If Gary Boyer had stayed at Dens, he might have been in a Dundee shirt. We just don't know. But it's what Dundee do, and I think the signings that Tony Docherty has made, we spoke about United, the spine of the team.
Yeah.
You know, and we'll come on to the
but
fact...
But he's signed enough to make a full team and have a sub-goalkeeper.
Yeah.
Of all the players he's brought in, somebody's got 12.
You love a goalkeeper.
Good grief. They do. I mean, it's the Carson thing started way back early in the right at the start
June.
Of the summer, wasn't it? Yeah,
it was June.
And it seemed to all go quiet on that. And the fact that they brought in, you know, John McCracken, that looked as though it was dead in the water. But, you know, now he's turned up. It shows how highly he is regarded by Tony Docherty, that he has gone out and got him, and he obviously feels that the points he's going to be number one, there's no doubt about that. He'll be the number one
choice. Spend money on him, making a 3-year deal. Yeah.
But he obviously feels the points that Carson can win this Dundee team will go a long way and the experience he brings will go a long way to keeping Dundee in the division. And you've just got to trust the manager, judgment on that. I've got to say, I think he's a Trevor Carson. I think he's a fantastic. I've heard Tom Carson years and years ago in the Dundee. Tom Carson must be in his 60s now. He's a seasonal sign for Dundee. Trevor Carson, I think he's a terrific goalkeeper. And you only have to go back to the Scottish Cup tie between the sides last season. And he was one of the reasons Dundee didn't actually go through that. He also made a couple of big saves during the 90 minutes as well. I've always been a big admirer of Trevor Carson. So, centre of defence as well. You know, they brought in Joe Shaughnessy. He's been, as I say, he's been cruising through games. They brought in Amadou Bakayoko.
Well done, yeah.
Up top. And
I like the look of him.
To look at him instantly, because he showed a bit of experience at certain times, you know. And he's a big lad. He looks well capable of knocking a few boys about. I think it's very early days, you know, to make too many sort of judgments on him as things stand, but he looked exactly to me what they need. If he can score goals, even better. You know, we've got to find that one out yet. But huge squad, lots and lots of players. I mean, there's just so many. I would expect a few possibly to go on loan. But hey, Pep Guardiola doesn't worry about having a squad about 37, 38 players. So I'm sure people go, you only need 11 players to play the game. Managers won't be concerned about the amount of players they've got on reserve. He's in a fortunate position to have guys who have, you know, good experience to come on and play. And that's what Dundee's going to need for this Premier League. And hopefully there'll be a big crowd at Dens on Saturday. The League Cup ties have been a couple of thousand, but Saturday I would expect...
The season tickets.
I would expect over 6,000 at Dens. I'm sure Motherwell will bring a decent support through. You know, the pitch is looking fantastic, and hopefully Dundee can get off to a good start.
And I did promise right at the start that we wouldn't compare any of Dundee's signings to any huge stars of the 70s and 80s, and Bears just compared Tony Docherty to Pep Guardiola.
Well, I compared Trevor Carson to Tom Carson. Apologies.
Alan, what do you make of the Carson arrival?
I find it peculiar. Yeah. I find it a bit peculiar. If it's the reported six-figure fee...
Well, we know some of them have been a wee bit cheeky with these things.
Yeah, I would be staggered if Dundee have paid St Mirren six figures without it being wildly staggered or contingent or something or other. You allude to it there, but St Mirren were a little bit naughty with their Declan Gallagher putting on Twitter that they'd sold him for an undisclosed fee when in actuality... It is an undisclosed fee, but will only come into effect if Dundee United are promoted. So it's a future fee that might not happen. So they are they know how to pad messaging. We'll put it that way. But taking away the finances,
they will have paid a fee for it.
Yeah, absolutely. But taking away the finances for a player of that age, he is quite clearly a vastly experienced goalkeeper, will win them points, as you know, reading your stuff in the paper, you know, I don't think there's any doubt that he will win Dundee points. I remember thinking, and you know, it was visible, the amount of points that, for example, Benji Sigrist saved Dundee United when he wasn't in the team. It must have been about a 20-point swing, and that's no exaggeration. He was that good, and sadly, the replacement was that bad, but it's...
Well, the replacement was supposed to be Trevor Carson, though, wasn't
it? Yeah, of course. Well, yeah, that's... decision-making. Yeah. The other interesting question is what it means for example, a John McCracken.
Absolutely.
You know, I do wonder to myself what Norwich are thinking exactly, because they've effectively had a young player who wouldn't have got many minutes, perhaps sitting on the bench, but... He's now been sent up to Scotland to sit on the bench in Scotland. I don't get what's in for Norwich, and if Dundee are paying anything for him, I don't really get what's in it for Dundee. I don't know whether this is just a case of when an opportunity that is too good to ignore comes up, you take that opportunity. That could very well be the case, but if it pans out, as I suspect it will pan out, I do wonder if we'll see McCracken going back to Norwich in January.
I did wonder that. I wonder whether maybe because it takes so long, it was back in June when the Carson thing kind of arrived, maybe they came to the thinking they would concentrate elsewhere, and they brought in McCracken for far less money in terms of a loan deal. And it just so happened that further down the line, they got their bodies in and they had the extra budget to go back and get Carson. Because McCracken, he's played the three out of the four.
Yeah.
So it looked like he was in the hot seat for that spot.
I feel Adam Legsons, we know what Adam Legsons can do, but he didn't have hardly anything to do in the games he played in pre-season, and even in the sort of Viaplay Cup games. I've got to say, John McCracken didn't have a huge amount to do as well, but probably made more saves.
He did quite well on Sunday, I thought.
Yeah. Looking at Sunday's game, though, I think the way the game panned out and Dundee got desperate for a second goal, you have a chance, we'll have a chance. So there was saves to be made, but he made them all, I've got to say. He looks incredibly comfortable with the ball at his feet. He looks as though he could play outside in five sides, no problem whatsoever. Mm-hmm. It is a strange one, but you've got to be prepared in football that, you know, these things will happen. Dundee had three keepers last season, and Harry Sharp and Big Lawler and Adam Legsdens, and they all got a fair amount of game time over the course of the season. They all got their chance to show.
They all did well.
They did. And you know, I don't wish any ill luck on Trevor Carson. He's just at the club, but he has had injury issues in the past. Mm-hmm. So you have to have good backup there. And as you said right at the start, George, about Tony Docherty, he does like three goalkeepers. He obviously doesn't want to be left in a situation, you know, whereby you've effectively got one goalkeeper, and if somebody gets injured, you're down to your young lad in the reserve sort of thing. So he's well covered in that situation. So he's certainly got the goalkeeping situation well sorted out. It's just how he fits them all into the team, not just to the goalkeepers, but everybody else as well. He's brought in the Mexicans, you know, he's brought in quite a few others as well. This is where it's going to be interesting for Tony Docherty. It's going to be a first for him, because he's always been, you know, an assistant boss. He's not had to tell players the day of the game or the day before the game, son, you're not in the starting squad, and you know what? You're not even on the bench, because Dundee have got that many players. They're not all going to get a jersey on Saturday. So it's how he deals with them, and some players will take it well and just get the head down and work, but some players could take the cream puff, as we've seen in the past. Mm-hmm. But everybody, I mean, there's a lot of games to be played. I'm sure everybody will get the chance to show what they can do.
Just as an observation on the squad building that you're touching on there, I mean, the one thing I notice is there's quite a great deal of youth in there, and also there's not an awful lot of Scottish Premiership experience, which speaks well to the imagination and the, you know, the breadth of scouting, obviously, but risky for a newly promoted team, you might guess.
Yeah, I that's my main worry, really, because you look at all the, particularly the players in on loan, they all look really talented. You have to say that. It looks like there's plenty of quality in there. Mm-hmm. It comes down to the mentality side of things and the experience that, and dealing with. There's going to be setbacks. Yeah. A new team in the Premiership, they're going to possibly lose more games than they win, probably. So you have to deal with that, and that's something that Joe Shaughnessy particularly, you can see why Tony Docherty wanted to bring him in, and he was one of was he the first one, I think, or second one maybe after Tiffany.
And of course that'll make Trevor Carson's job much easier as well. He's got the centre half he played with.
But he also, speaking to him yesterday, he spoke about the experience of Carson. He said that was really important as well, that bringing in the right sort of mentality in his goalkeeper as well. So that's an addition to, obviously, he's been around the block. He's 35 years old. He's played for big teams and played for Northern Ireland. So I think that was part of the thinking as well, to get another experienced man in there. So he's got four keepers at the moment as we record. We're expecting Harry Sharp to head to Dunfermline. Possibly by the time this podcast comes out, but we'll wait and see. But for a talented young keeper, that's not a bad move, Alan. Is it a big club, Dunfermline? There's a lot of expectation. He's gonna learn a fair bit. Obviously, playing under his old manager as well.
Yeah, covered Dunfermline with a fair degree of regularity in the past, and they are a big football club with real expectations. And I think he'll be tested. I know they're going to add David Wotherspoon to their ranks as well this week, but I don't think Dunfermline's depth is spectacular. I don't think they've added an awful lot. They are being, quite understandably, after the tribulations of administration and everything, they are being sensible. They are living within their means, but the squad doesn't look huge compared to what they had last season. And so I think Harry Sharp will be tested. I think there will be games where he's under the cosh. And all the while, although I'm saying, you know, they might struggle and they might, the expectation for Dunfermline fans is always that they should be up towards the top end of the second tier. So he will have that weight of expectation to deal with. So it's a great move. If he's a big enough character, if he can handle it, and obviously you'll know him a lot better than me, then it's a great move. It's a real formative experience if you're big enough to handle it. And presumably James McPake will know him well enough to know whether he is the right character. And I expect that to be a really interesting to see how he does, really, because I think it's a very different challenge ahead for him. If he does become, for whatever reason, the number one at Dunfermline, compared to staking a claim but probably never really feeling like the number one at Dundee, I think it's a different challenge. And yeah, really fascinating to see how he sort of stands up to it. He will certainly return to Dens Park a better goalkeeper. I'm 99% sure of that.
No, I agree. I think that's a good move for everybody involved, I have to say. I was impressed with him last season. Obviously, he lost his place in the end. He was maybe a wee bit inexperienced at times, but he also, when he made his debut, he came out of nowhere, didn't he? I think it was COVID time. I think Ian Lawler was, Langston's was out. Lawler picked up COVID on the morning of the game or something like that at Motherwell. And Harry Sharp was chucked straight in and did really well.
Yeah, I don't think he's done anything wrong. I think he's looked very competent. And one thing that worries me, he doesn't look the tallest. Goalkeepers nowadays, as we've seen, tend to be 6'4", 6'5". You know, although Trevor Carson is not that. I do admit that. He's coming from a position though where he has established himself as a number one. You know, Harry Sharp has to go and do that. I think he has to go and play games. That's a fact. I mean, there's no point in him sitting on the bench a full season at Dens. His development will stall incredibly. You know, you'll get a chance at Dunfermline, I'm sure, to do that and, you know, go and show just how good a goalkeeper he actually is. So, yeah, it's a good move. It's a good move for everyone, George, I think.
Quite aside from the, you know, the Dundee connection that James McPake's got as well, I think he's a good manager to go and work for if you're a young player, because I think we could go over all ground in terms of the amount of debuts he gave to Dundee players. Everyone listening of the Dundee persuasion will know that. But even since he's gone to Dunfermline, the tune that he's getting out of Matty Todd, who was fantastic last season, really positive. He's brought on Chris Mockery when he was on loan from Dundee United, and you're certainly a wee glimpse of kind of what Lewis McCann can do, another young player at Dunfermline, brother of Ali McCann, obviously. Mm-hmm. And he gives young players an opportunity, and like we were discussing earlier, basically says to them, you know, I'll keep you in the team until you play your way out the team. So I think that's a real positive, and that's all you want as a young player. So I think he's going to play for a good manager.
And Bear, you mentioned about players not even making the matchday squad just before. One of those on Sunday was Sean Byrne. I noticed when I arrived at Dens Park, maybe just over an hour before kickoff, which was quite early for me, I have to say.
Very early for you, George.
Yeah, I was like, I don't know what was
wrong.
You
must have thought it was a 2 o'clock kickoff last week.
But he was on the pitch doing training by himself.
Yeah.
Which is interesting to see. Obviously, he wants to be in that team, but he's not played a single minute.
No. That could be telling. Obviously, under contract for another season. I think it's down to Sean Byrne. You know, is he prepared to spend another season warming the bench, which he may be doing, or I'm sure he'd have... Sean Byrne is a very, very talented footballer, but he's not the right fit for Dundee, obviously, for where they are at this point in time. And, you know, there may be other clubs out there that think he could do a job. I certainly think at Championship level would be a valuable, valuable addition for someone in the club. We've just been speaking about Dunfermline. I don't know if James McPake would like him over there, but
no doubt he would.
I think he is an experienced player who can take the ball. He knows when to put a tackle in, and he passes the ball very well as well. So there's a lot to like about Sean Byrne, but unfortunately for him, he's like it's football, George. He's just been squeezed out, and you know, it's up to him to decide what he's going to do, what he's going to do next, and make the best move for him and for his family, obviously, as well. Sorry, excuse me. Looking at Dundee as a whole, I think that he's got lots of players. You know, there's no doubt about that. The biggest, I'll be interested to see who he plays on Saturday, first of all. But I think most of all, I'll be interested to see the formation, what setup he uses. If he uses the three at the back or he reverts back to a four. Now, for me, I get the fear with three at the back. I think they were exposed on Sunday, against Inverness on the right-hand side where Lee Ashcroft was playing. Not because of Lee Ashcroft especially, but I think it was more to do who was playing on the right-hand side. It was Josh Mulligan, who likes to get forward and leaves far too big a gap at times. Now,
I could hear Lee Ashcroft yelling at him.
What was happening was Lee Ashcroft was getting himself exposed with a guy, Nathan Shaw, who is a good player at Aberdeen. Now, he's got good feet. And Nathan Shaw was buzzing past him at the edge of the box. Now, that happens in the Premier League. Exactly the same thing will happen. For me, I think the manager's got a choice to make. He's got the three central defenders. Portales, I don't think, put a foot wrong last week. I think he won most balls in the air. He looked more comfortable on the left-hand side because he wasn't getting exposed as much because Owen Beck plays as a left-back. Now, the manager's got a choice to make. Does he stick with the three centre-backs or does he basically say, we're going to go with a four and one of them has to drop out? If he sticks with the three, I would suggest that he has to look at the right-hand side of the partner. As much as Josh Mulligan brings to Dundee FC, for me and for Lee Ashcroft, I think he'd be more suited by a guy like Cammy Kerr playing it on that right-hand side, a more natural defender. Yeah. Now, that's a big call because you don't get the same impact going forward. But we can't have Lee Ashcroft being exposed on that right-hand side week in, week out, because there are talented players in that league who will just ghost past him. When we're talking, he's going to be putting in rash tackles, maybe penalty kicks. He just can't be exposed like that. So unless a manager has a word with Mulligan and says, look, you're going to have to play a wee bit deeper, but it's not in his game. I also think that there were times that Dundee were taking you know, goal kicks. So, and it was Joe McCracken. And Lee Ashcroft was going 10 yards into the opposition half.
I think he was to be the target if they were going long, I think.
But that leaves a massive hole. Yeah. If you're only playing three at the back, that leaves a huge hole. One misplaced header, Alan, a header that goes maybe not... If Ashcroft doesn't win it properly and knock it on, if he heads it square and it goes to an opposition player, the right-hand flank is wide open.
Yeah.
You know, so I don't like it. You can see I'm not a big fan of it. I think you can play it, but it's got to be the right personnel. It's
interesting. I think maybe Aaron Donnelly, the lad brought in from Nottingham Forest, who's unfortunately injured. They're waiting to hear how bad he's turned his ankle. So I think he was signed to play on the left of that back three. That seems to be his favourite position, although he can play wing-back and full-back. So I wonder whether he was signed to play on that left-hand side because he's left-sided. But interestingly, I was at the Dundee B game on Wednesday against Bucky Thistle. Some interesting players playing, but they played the 3-5-2 formation. So I'm wondering whether that's going to be the first choice and they're trying to get that through the into the youth team as well.
What does that mean for the more attacking wide players that Dundee have got? Because, for example, Scott Tiffany was a marquee signing.
I know, and that's the...
Scott Tiffany does not play anywhere in a 5.
Well, he played him in the number 10 on Sunday. It's not.
I don't mean literally can't play anywhere. I mean in terms of you getting the best out of Scott Tiffany. He needs to play wide.
You could see that. He got taken off at half-time. He didn't have a great game. Lyle Cameron came on, and he's a lot more suited to that central position.
Yeah.
So it might just be one of these, depending on the opposition, depending who's fit and who's in form, that Tony Docherty switches between the 3 and the 4. I'm kind of with Bear on the 3. I feel like there's a lot more moving parts in a 3. If you get it right, it's really effective.
Yeah.
You could see the teams, Antonio Conte is obviously the master at it. When his teams get it right, they're really, really difficult to beat. But there's more moving parts, so there's more chance of risk, I think.
Also allows you a 2 up front, which
that's the other thing.
I wonder if that's the major benefit that Tony Docherty's.
Well, the second half, Bakayoko and Robinson together up front is a very, very strong in terms of physical strength, too. There's plus points and kind of negatives in terms of Scott Tiffany.
You spoke about Scott Tiffany, and he didn't have a great game. He prefers to be out wide. You saw that when he got the ball, he tended to drift over to the right. But it's early days, but from a Dundee point of view, I thought Luke McCowan came on and did well when he came on. So maybe he's
a right wing back.
Yeah, he's put himself into the picture. But I do feel that Lee Ashcroft, and I'm the Lee Ashcroft's biggest fan. But I like to see him in between the posts and not going much further than that either side, to be perfectly honest. Yeah. When he's taken away across to right back and there's acres of space, like you say, Nathan Shaw is a very clever player. I think he's a player who could play at a higher level, to be honest. He's got really good feet. But he just ghosted past him a couple of times. We can't have that. I mean, there'll be players of Nathan Shaw's ability and better in the top flight who will take Lee Ashcroft to the cleaners unless he gets better cover.
Be first taste of VAR as well, Dennis Park. I haven't been a game yet with a video assistant referee, if that's what it is, isn't it?
Mm-hmm.
I can tell by Alan's face that it's really exciting and really adds to the spectacle, does it?
It's slow, the communication's terrible, it breaks up the game, I'm not a huge admirer of that. I'd rather people were just allowed to make mistakes the same way that football players are allowed to make mistakes. However, this is the situation we've got ourselves in by vilifying referees and using them as a scapegoat for every defeat after in post-match press conferences for so many years. So it is what it is. But no, I don't enjoy it as a spectacle, don't enjoy it as a working experience, and I don't think the supporters enjoy it much either. So that was it's the only positive to Dundee United's relegation. Cannot wait for a season where games actually end on 90 plus 3 minutes rather than when you tally in the VARs 90 plus 14 effectively.
So what are you feeling about it, Bear?
Well, it's all new, and it's going to be new for the Dundee supporters, and let's hope that it doesn't spoil the moment tomorrow. That's what Premier League fans have become used to the Premiership, the top flight clubs who have been using it for the past season or so. And, you know, unfortunately, you become a wee bit accustomed now not to celebrate a goal too much just in case.
Yeah.
You know, are all the boxes ticked, you know, but it's going to happen for sure. And hope, I mean, like everything else, it'll happen in Dundee's favour and it'll be against Dundee as well. But it's the same for every team in the top flight. I think there are good points to it, but when it spoils the flow of the game, and as Alan says, there's a communication problem as well, and the length of time it can take sometimes. George, this is going to impact on us being back in the pub after the game. This is going to, if we're having sort of stoppage time, it's going into 10, 11 minutes at the game, you know.
Well, it sounds like, I was up at Dens for the pre-match press conference yesterday, and it sounds like the meeting they had with the SFA referees went strongly into added time. It was supposed to be an hour, it ended up almost 2 hours, I think, and the players and coaches weren't particularly happy with that, because there was a lot of boring stuff, I think.
It's part and parcel of the game, and you've got to accept that.
There was still a bit of confusion over the handball rule. Yeah. Some of the players think one thing, and I think the rule's the other way. There's still confusion.
There was a few glaring errors last season, absolutely glaring errors. You wonder who was looking at these things, and it's subjective calls, but they were so bad.
I'm clearly grumpy and don't like the logistics of it, but worth noting, it is what it is. You know, that's just me moaning. However, Bear's right, the actual decision making, the actual implementation also has to improve, because I don't particularly like the system, I don't like having it. But a bigger issue than that, in my personal view, is I think there was bad decisions made last season and there needs to be an improvement. Mm-hmm. Bear's right.
I saw a programme, it was on the English Premier League, and it was Howard Webb explaining how they'd got to a decision that the fans couldn't understand. I can't remember exactly what it was. It was an incident prior to an incident, something like that, that they'd gone back and had to look at first. But the fact that he actually was able to explain it, it became clear. That's where they need to get to in Scottish football as well. But football's a game about momentum. You want the game to continue to flow. If it stops and there's huge gaps, you know, that just makes it for a poor spectacle.
Mm-hmm. Well, let's hope it's not a poor spectacle in terms of Dundee fans. Finished off the United bit with a bit of predictions, so we better do that with Dundee. Bear, I'll throw to you first.
Oh, thanks, George.
Where are they finishing?
I'll get in my where Dundee will finish and who will finish below them.
we're giving it away already.
Early days for Dundee. The squad building looks good. I would be quite satisfied anywhere in the bottom six. Preferably...
But not the bottom two.
Preferably not a last day snatch to try and get a few points to keep their heads above water. Mm. You know, I'll go for eighth, George, which I'd be quite happy with. Wow. Below them, I think there's a couple of teams got issues at the moment. St Johnson, I think... Livingston's day has come. I hope David Martindale don't give him my address. and maybe Motherwell. I think Motherwell, you know, did really well last season under Stuart Kettlewell. There's a theme going here. But they've lost a big player in Kevin Van Veen up top, and Callum Butcher's injured as well. So the two big players out of their team to begin with. So I think the signing of Theo Bear looks a bit desperate to me. I'm sorry to say that, but you know, it's for him coming in late in the window when they probably could have done that business a wee bit earlier if they wanted to, suggest that, you know, that they really needed to get someone and they've not been able to get who they wanted, so they've gone and got him. So I'm hoping for Dundee enough points, as I've always said, point a game does it, and that's what Dundee should be looking for. We don't want, it doesn't have to be wins every week, but as long as you don't go and, you know, losing runs of four or five games at a time, I'm sure Tony Docherty will make sure that doesn't happen.
So our Dundee United writer, there's no danger here.
11th, St Johnstone go down, Malachi Boateng will have a good season.
Interesting.
Just on Boateng, he's getting better every week.
I thought he was very good on Sunday, I have to say. I'm kind of with Bear. I think around about 8th, 9th. I think
positive.
Well, there's a lot of talent in the players. I think there might be inconsistency, as we can expect from young players. So there'll be some really good days, I think. There'll be some pretty bad days.
I think the one area we could concern me probably the most is taking chances.
That's been the issue at the moment, yeah.
They still look as though they're passing up too many chances.
That was an issue last season as well, wasn't it?
Yeah.
No, I agree. I think they could do with... they've signed enough players already. Yeah. I don't think he's stopping, though.
Yeah.
I think they could maybe do with a wee bit more in the middle in terms of experience.
Yeah, I think so.
Premiership player.
I would agree with that.
But I think that's enough waffle. We've gone for over an hour already. So I think we'll call it a day. But thanks very much for listening. And we'll be back next week for week 2 of the Premiership and Championship.